cameras.
Only from the mind of Minolta.
Two famous moms for Philips Milk of Magnesia.
We're here to gently remind you how much you can depend upon your mom.
Mom knows best.
When you're feeling...
not yourself.
Out of sorts.
We understand, dear.
You need your mom.
Philips Milk of Magnesia, the laxative for dependable overnight relief.
It helps your body work naturally.
So you know it's gentle, like mom.
Nobody treats you better than mom.
You'll feel better.
Leave it to mom.
Stripe Hit Rich with a PBA Tour. Live every Wednesday night. ESPN brings you the world's greatest bowlers as they compete in championship round action. ESPN begins the season with live coverage of the Showboat Senior Invitational. Dick Weber tries for an unprecedented fourth consecutive win, but a top field of competitors will try to stop him. Live Wednesday, June 14th on ESPN.
Say what you want about the Los Angeles Lakers, that they are so talented that all one has to do is press a button and they'll win. But if you know sports at all, especially pro sports, you know that just is not the case. Folks, we'll let you in on a little secret. Pat Riley has done one heck of a coaching job for the Showtime Lakers. Summoned from the broadcast booth in 1980 for an assistance job to Paul Westhead, Riley has then taken over and taken the Lakers to 7 NBA championship appearances. He's won 4 NBA titles. His 98 playoff wins tie him as number one all-time in playoff wins with the hallowed Red Auerbach, not to mention a regular season record of 470 and a .175. And he's done it with so much style. Our Larry Burnett and our Monday morning conversation spoke with Riley.
A lot has been made about Pat Riley, California cool, style, clothes, everything else. Has that gotten in the way of your accomplishments as a coach?
I don't think so. You know, everything that I am, you know, I brought to, the game for me. I mean, I was this way before I was a coach. You know, my dad was a coach in baseball his whole life, and he was also a very stern disciplinarian. I was always a person that said yes, sir, no, sir to adults, and I meant it. He made sure that all of his children were groomed and cleaned, and my dad was a 40s dapper-looking guy. We used to have hand-me-downs. My brothers used to fight over, you know, when he used to hand down his... These Charmaine gabardine shirts and these heavy 15-ounce wool blazers, you know. So my dad was a great example for us because that's what he was about, and that's what I carried on into life. And so when I brought it into the NBA, everybody thought that, well, all of a sudden he became a coach and all of a sudden he's in a style and everything. But that isn't what it's about. I think if that's the perception by the public, then I can't control that.
You had a very interesting relationship with your dad, didn't you?
Yeah. I mean, all of us have mentors. And, I had 14 coaches, but the greatest coach was my father. He was a coach and he was a father to me. And he was a very disciplined man. He didn't say a whole lot, but, you know, his facial expressions and the things that he did say to me were enough. I didn't need much from him either, but... he taught me a lot, and for all the people out there who sort of go through life and feel like that, well, you know, my dad was too tough on me, or he didn't give me enough love, or he didn't encourage me enough, is regardless of what the situation is, make sure you have a chance to tell him that you love him before he goes, because say what you have to say to him, because it happens like that.
You were a great college basketball player, had great success. In the pros, you struggled, you scrapped for everything you had. Has that experience in the pros made you a better coach?
I learned my place early in my professional basketball career that I was not one of those guys. I was not a superstar.
Does that bug you that you weren't?
Well, from a competitive nature, yeah. It did, yeah. But I think one of the great attributes of a team player is to understand exactly where he fits in. And I wanted a career, and I wanted to play, and I wanted to be part of a team, and I wasn't about to let my ego... you know, get out of line to the point where, you know, I believed I should be a starter and a star, and I really wasn't. So being part of was more important than me being the person who stirred the drink. And I think once you learn that as a player, then you will fit in. You will find a role. You will find a place where you can help a team. And I do think suppressing my ego early in my career and becoming part of and being a supportive factor has helped me do that as a coach.
Pat, with all the NBA championships, with all the 60-win seasons, you still have never been the coach of the year in the NBA. Does that bother you?
I think it bothered me more my first couple of years than it does now, but I'm a lot like what our players are now. And it doesn't make any difference who does it as long as the team wins. You know, Magic, for his first 8 years, was never the most valuable player. Could care less. Really could care less, because it was all about winnings. And it sort of become infectious. So it doesn't bother me. Maybe someday it will come, and it'd be flattering, it'd be nice, but it's about winning. And, you know, that's what excites me.
How do you choose which championship ring you're going to wear?
To me, there's no doubt which one it is. It's the 85. Ring that I wear. I don't have it on right now, but, and it's very rarely that I don't have it on, but to me, being part of a team that grew, and we were not a great team until 1985. I mean, I have sort of a phrase for each year. In 1979-80, when we got Magic Johnson the first time, it was what I call the year of the innocent climb. You know, we just sort of became a team. He showed up. We didn't realize how great he was, and then all of a sudden we won a championship. And the year 1981, it was the year of what I call the disease of Moore. We didn't know how to handle our success. The team fragmented. There was dissension, and we lost. And in 1982, it was what I call our first growth. That team would not ever allow us to get beat because of dissension. We got beat by, we'd get beat by a team, but not because of what we referred to as the disease of more. What you do is you want more minutes, more time, more recognition, more money, more everything, and you give less of yourself. And that happens when you're young. And we won a championship in 82, and in 1983 we lost because of the natural phenomenon of injuries. We got swept by Philadelphia. In 1984, our fifth year together, we choked against the Celtics. They were a great team. We were a great team. But I felt we had our best team, and we lost. And it took 5 years of innocent climbs, of dissension, of first growth, of injuries, of choking. And then in 1985, this team broke through. And for the first time, they beat the Celtics in Boston Garden. And it was simply my greatest moment as a coach or a player. And I think that was the moment that our team finally did plant their feet. They stood firm, and they made a point about who they were. And they were simply a great team, and they proved it.
You got to tell me now, is Pat Riley Hollywood, or does he just live near it?
Well, I live near it. You know, I've been living in California since 1967, and I love it out here. And I think the whole Laker team, you know, suffers from this contradiction.
You also have been part of a decade of Kareem, which ends this year.
Yeah.
Can you put into words what he's meant to you, what he's meant to the team?
What Kareem has done for this team more than anything is he has taught this team about resiliency. I mean, Kareem has been written off since he's been 33 years old, but he'd always find a way to bounce back and have a great performance. And in 1985, when they tried to run him out of town in Boston after game one, you know, he bounced back with the most valuable player performance, and he's won two championships since then. So what Kareem has mentored this team with is a incredible durability to resiliency and to be able to bounce back and be refined. The fabric of the team is there, and I think that's what he has taught us, and I think that's what he's going to leave us with. His legacy will be that you can constantly always go above and beyond, even when you don't think you can, and especially when your critics don't think you can. He has taught us that.
Lighten it up a little bit here. Do you have any idea how many suits you have?
I don't. I have a lot. I'll tell you, I do have a lot. But I do it for efficiency. It takes me, you know, people think that because you dress that I must take hours to get ready. I get dressed in 5 minutes because it's efficient. I know exactly what suit I'm going to wear. There's one shirt, there's one tie, and I don't have to puff my hair up because I just slick it back and comb it back. It takes about 20 seconds. And I'm out the door in 5 minutes. And so I think probably a lot of my decision-making that goes into the selection of clothes is because of efficiency. I don't like to mess around. I like to get on with it and move on.
Really, what do you do with the hair? Is it
I just come right out of the shower, and I just, you know, I just put some gel in it and comb it back, and that's it. And I used to blow dry it. You know, that'd take 20 minutes, you know, when I was into the wispy willowy look, but I'm not anymore. The irony to it, my dad used to wear his hair like this, and as soon as I combed my hair back, my whole life changed back in 1979-80. So it's not a bad way to go for all you guys out there.
Pat Riley, I think the interesting thing about Riley all the way is that the leg, you know, it is very easy to be a champion and to not do it in a classy style. And I think that the team in that way definitely takes its character from him. When you have basketball players and athletes at that level, still to have the team take your character and exhibit it on the court, I think that speaks for the way that he's done his job. I know you agree.
I certainly do.
Chuck Daly, continuing our thought on the finals, his opponent, Riley's opponent in the finals, will be our next Sunday night / Monday morning conversation. Chuck Daly, man who coached at Penn in the mid-70s when I was at Brown. That'll be our conversation next week.
Will he be talking about that?
Somehow I don't think he'll get to that one. It's not a five-hour talk.
There's more to come on this Sunday night edition of the Sports Center. And when we return, we'll look back to Saturday night and Sunday morning, the Dodgers and the Astros in their marathon. We'll be back.
Ever happened to you? What a mess. How about this? It doesn't wear as well as it tastes. That dress shirt and expensive silk blouse have had it. Or have they? Now there's a way to deal with the most difficult stains quickly, safely, and thoroughly. DD7. DD7 is a super concentrated formula that removes stains but won't harm fabric. Now where's the ink? Even this delicate silk blouse comes incredibly clean. And that's not all. Tar, iodine, blood, rust. DD7 gets rid of them all. Are your window shears dull and gray? A quick soak in diluted DD7 restores them to a like-new white. DD7 is a whiz on carpets, even upholstery. Think of the money you'll save. We've stained these hands with ink, iodine, and car grease. Just watch. DD7 and a little water instantly remove the stain, even from under the fingernails. And there's more. Imagine this is your washing machine. A red sock gets in with the whites. Everything turns pink. Ink from a broken pen. Even iodine. A little multi-purpose DD7 in the final rinse, and it's goodbye to all those unwanted stains forever. Order your tube of DD7 today for just $14.95, or we'll double your order for only $5 more. That's two tubes for only $19.95. Enough to replace all these expensive cleaners at a fraction of the price. If DD7 doesn't work this quickly and easily for you, simply return the unused portion for a refund. Have your credit card ready and order now.
Call toll-free 1-800-453-6600. That's 1-800-453-6600. Or send $14.95 for one tube, or save $10 by sending $19.95 for two tubes, plus $4 shipping to DD7, Box 8989-S, Buffalo Grove, Illinois. That's DD7. Box 8989-S, Buffalo Grove, Illinois.
Sunday's 13-inning Dodgers-Astros game at the Dome may have seemed like a long one, but it was like a burp compared to the 22-inning affair last night between the same two teams. Now, it is possible that some of you may have missed some of the subtleties of that one, so here it is. And God bless the National League for not having a curfew like they do in the AL. Otherwise, I mean, the sun wouldn't be coming up when you're leaving the park. 4-4, bottom of the 10th, Caminiti at third base, but Rafael Ramirez strikes out with a chance to win the game. The 11th inning, Craig Reynolds at third, and Gerald Young with the fly ball to center field. T-Bone Shelby with the throw. Socha will try and block the plate. He does so. Reynolds is out of the 11th, and so we go to the 15th. Oral Hershiser working 7 innings in relief with the bases loaded, pitching to Alex Trevino. The fly to Chris Gwynn in left. Terry swimming pool, trying to win it. He is out! And let's face it, not everyone through the entire game could stay bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Futility award, John T-Bone Shelby, who in the 22nd inning flies out. He went 0 for 10. John says, I like hamburger helper, not T-Bone. Things get Fernando playing at first, holding the runner on. Jeff Hamilton pitching, you kidding? Caminiti does this to his bat, taking out his frustration. But in the 22nd inning, Rafael Ramirez off of the glove of Fernando. Mike Davis going to throw home. Bill Doran scores. And in 22 innings, 7 hours and 14 minutes, the Astros beat the Dodgers by a count of 5-4. Socha said he would have argued about a guy running out of the base, but he was too tired. Pitchers used 16. Pitches thrown, 613. They used 12 dozen balls. Usually they use 5 or 6 in a game. Guys that ended up playing places that they don't normally, Eddie Eat, Drink, and B. Murray, played 30. Came up as a third baseman way, way back. Fernando, you saw his effort at first. Jeff Hamilton on the mound. By the way, his ERA now 5.40 if you're scoring at home. And Oral pitching 7 innings in relief. Glenn Davis, after the game, slept in the trainer's room because there was a day game the next day, as you know. And pity the Dodgers. They go on for a twi-nighter on Monday in Atlanta.
On to boxing now with the Sugar Ray Leonard-Thomas Hearns fight just around the corner. We once again have a fight ballyhooed as the bout of the century because, among other things, it pits two men we have seemingly known forever. That seems to be the way. Big names returning to the ring. Charles Steiner has more.
It seems like they've been with us forever. Some of boxing's biggest box office attractions from the 70s.
The winner is George Foreman.
And the early 80s.
Tito Davis is down.
The megastars. And the matinee idols. They've come and gone and come back again. And again. The seniors of boxing are still the biggest draws in the fight game. 4 months ago, at the ripe old age of 37, the remarkable Roberto Duran wrested the WBC middleweight championship from Iran Barkley in what has been so far the fight of the year. A month later, Ray Boom Boom Mancini returned to the ring after a 4-year hiatus, only to lose a controversial decision to a guy named Macho. And then there's George Foreman, 15 years removed from the heavyweight championship of the world, and looking it. But he's been disposing of some of the division's lesser lights for the past 2 years. At the age of 41, Foreman's skills seem to be out of the realm of title contention. But then again, this is boxing. And now two more senior citizens are readying themselves for a sequel to their 1981 classic. Both 32-year-old Sugar Ray Leonard and 30-year-old Thomas Hearns are at the tail end of their respective careers. But on Monday night in Las Vegas, June 12th, they will face off again, this time with Leonard's WBC super middleweight title on the line, proving that fighters and fight fans can go home again.
I think it's trying to recapture what was. One of the reasons I think there are so many comebacks is the money. I think another reason there's so many comebacks, though, is because there is no one dominant fighter. There could be Mike Tyson, but you spend more time reading about Mike Tyson's episodes out of the ring than in the ring.
They take some Muhammad Ali. He kept it on the front page, the cover, Sports Illustrated, where he made people read about boxing. Who came next? Ray Leonard. He kept it on the page. Now, there has not been anyone after him. Now, because of Ray Leonard's fights with the Durans, with the Hearns, the Haglers, we created more fans. But the fans you created were not for the undercard fighters. They didn't go away saying, gee whiz, Tony Gonzalez sure was outstanding in that sixth rounder. They learned about Tommy Hearns, Ray Leonard, Marvin Hagler, Roberto Duran.
Skeptics of this fight complain that Leonard and Hearns are merely shadows of the past. But the fact of the matter is, older fighters have provided us with some of boxing's best moments. Jersey Joe Walcott was 37 when he won the heavyweight title from 31-year-old Ezra Charles in their third fight. The incomparable Sugar Ray Robinson fought Gene Fulmer 4 times between 1957 and 1961. In their last fight, Robinson was 40 years old. Arguably, the greatest fight in history was the third meeting between Muhammad Ali, who was 33 at the time, and Joe Frazier, who was 31. Their careers might have been on the decline, But indeed, they fought the thriller in Manila.
30 and 32 probably don't like to be referred to as senior citizens, but...
I think we can honestly say that.
In boxing, we know that they are. We'll have coverage of this fight upcoming between Leonard and Hearns all during the week with Charles Stein.
And when SportsCenter returns, it's that time. Plays of the Week making a comeback. Stay with us.
What's the best brokerage account for an active investor? Ask a Schwab customer.
With my Schwab One asset management account, my money's never idle. When I sell a stock or I get a dividend, my cash instantly starts earning income. And it keeps on earning until I make my next investment.
When I need to get to my cash or take out a loan, I just use my Schwab Visa or write a check. Schwab One makes it easy.
All my financial moves are right here, on one simple statement. Now, you might expect to pay a lot of money for an account this handy, and not with Schwab One. There's no monthly fee. Now, that's real value.
To get your free booklet and an application for the Schwab One Asset Management account, call toll-free 800-848-8900. That's 800-848-8900. Call now for your free Schwab One booklet.
Is it?
Yeah, it is. Time for Plays of the Week.
It's time once again to serve up a set of... We begin with Michael Jordan. Boy, does he ever have the right stuff. Another with the right stuff, Kevin Mitchell. Four dingers over the weekend in the launching pad. Only his teammates can cool him off. Cards look like they had this game won, but Mitch Webster homers to tie it with two outs. That's right, Whitey. It's out of here. Speaking of outs, umps are supposed to call players out, not knock them out. And this guy at the Kemper Open, he's just plain out. Hey, don't run away. There's lots more. Please come to Boston in the springtime. Big hit for Dave Loggins. Not for Terry Steinbach. Eric Davis, the cycle at home, but in Pittsburgh, the pits. Tim Eli Wallach in L.A. Scoreboard 2. Tim, nothing. Dave Henderson at home. Use two hands. Joe Carter at home. Doing a June Lockhart impersonation. He's lost in space. The Red Sox at home. Way up and gone. The Brewers at home. What was the number of that license plate anyway? And what's all this fuss about Fruit Loop? Just ask Sylvia Tettleton, Mickey's wife.
I fed him Fruit Loops, and he was eating them and having a really good spring. So I went and bought like two of the biggest boxes I could find, and now he's eating them again.
So Mickey's eating his loops and loving every minute. Like this fan who can't believe his eyes. Randy Nosek of the Tigers, try a slider next time. Alex Sanchez of the Indians needs a little work. Fernando on the mound. Fernando, try your glove. No, your foot. No, throw it home. Well. El Cid of the Mets, out of the picture. Got the picture? Watch this picture. 1-2 count, two out on Kurt. What was that man wearing? Strike three outs, right? No, Ernest Riles is off. The throw, it's in the outfield. Riles trying to score. Dykstra with the throw home. Out, four outs? Guys, I think you only need three. Glenn, Mr. Outside Davis of the Astros, didn't have time to think with this catch. He just kept going. And as we say goodbye, just be happy you don't have this guy's job. Unless you want some free LaCosta.
ESPN's Plays of the Week is brought to you by Apple Computer, maker of Macintosh personal computers, giving you the power to be your best.
With special low rates from Avis, you can afford to pack up the entire family for a great vacation. Avis, we try harder to make it easier. For business people on the rise, things are looking up. With great low rates from Avis, you'll really impress them at your next meeting. Avis, we try harder to make it easier.
Are you over 30 and single? Now you can find love and companionship right here on the telephone with the Romance Hotline. Just call 1-900-909-8000 and listen to recorded messages from exciting, sincere singles. If you're looking for romance, you'll find it here on the Romance Hotline.
The Romance Hotline, 1-900-909-8000. $2 first minute, 45 cents additional minutes.
For adults over 30 only, please.
Aggressive play is the key to victory at a tournament where the highest, not the lowest, score wins. The Pat Bradley International. 3 days of coverage begins Friday afternoon live on ESPN.
The NBA final opens Tuesday in Detroit as the Pistons host the champion Lakers. It's a rematch of last year's final and a chance for the Lakers to win three straight. But the series has another headline as Detroit's tough guy image takes center stage. As Larry Burnett tells us, Michael Jackson would be proud. The Pistons are really, really bad.
There are a couple players on our team that go beyond what they have to do to be competitive, and I think they deliberately try to hurt players on the opposing team.
Bad as a bad.
Well, as far as our image is concerned, we really don't care. All we care about is winning basketball games.
Rough stuff and intimidation. Some say it's all part of the Pistons' game plan. If the bad boys don't bother you at one end of the court, you're likely to be looking over your shoulder for them at the other end.
We use it to, you know, use it to our advantage because that's what we really, we just want to play good hard basketball, and we really don't care how people feel about us.
The Pistons even have a wall of shame in their locker room. It's their own personal gallery for the latest bad boy press clippings and fine announcements from the NBA. Detroit was bad enough to lead the league in fines this season. $29,000 in contributions. Mahorn and Lambeer are the ringleaders, and the fans at the Palace say, the badder the better.
I think it's a wonderful thing to have a bad image as good as theirs.
They think it helps them in their game, and it does help them. All the other teams are scared of them, and when they go up, they say, hey, we're going up against Ricky, we're going to get hit.
Tell me about your shirt. What does it mean?
The bad boys of the NBA. Toughest guys. Kill anybody. Everybody's afraid of us.
Folks outside of Detroit think the bad boys are the worst thing to come out of the Motor City since the Edsel.
You know, getting booed or sneered at, as you say, in the road, doesn't bother us. We kind of enjoy it. That means we're doing something right. We know going in their building that they're coming I sell out. Everywhere we go, we sell out. They're coming to boo us, to see us lose. And it's the greatest feeling going in there and busting their ass and winning the game.
Videos, T-shirts, posters, you name it, bad boy fans have bought it. The league isn't exactly thrilled with the image, and even the Pistons have learned that when you wear black hats, you better be ready for trouble.
Some people, before they come into the game, they've already decided that they're going to fight us no matter what.
And if you ride with the Outlaws, you're liable to get chased by the law.
I do think that they probably are told, now look, you're refereeing Mahorn tonight, or you're refereeing Lambeer, you're not refereeing number 52 or number 14. I guess that's only natural with their reputation.
Publicly, the bad boys promote their image. Privately, they've paid the price for it. No one mentions that the sale of this poster has already earned more than $50,000 for charity. Mahorn's own mother won't even watch his games anymore. And his work with kids is overshadowed. His basketball talents overlooked.
Yeah, per se. I figure they think I'm a thug or a villain, whatever. But, you know, I wouldn't be in this league for 9 years if I couldn't play basketball.
Lambeer is the tall man's answer to Danny Ainge these days. Always a face, always a comment, and always ready to help the officials. His bad boy antics have made Lambeer the target of taunts and insults on and off the court.
All the harassment that I've received used to bother my family, but they understand over the course of time now that this is the entertainment business. And people pay good money to come, and if they want to boo and holler and scream at us, that's their prerogative. They understand that if I have to wear the black hat to work and be the villain, well, so be it. That's just part of the business.
I'm Larry Burnett, ESPN.
The series starts on Tuesday. This time around, it's the Pistons with the home court advantage. Starts at 9 Eastern time. And I like the Pistons. Who do you like?
Well, now that you brought it up, I like the 6'9" point guard with the smile, the guy in the middle with the skyhook, and the coach with the hair. Lakers in 7, 3 in a row. We'll be back in a moment. Stay with me.
SportsCenter is brought to you by Busch Beer, the beer with a taste as smooth as its name.
Come on, along. Come on, along. Head for the mountain. It's cold and it's smooth and it's waiting for you. Head for the mountain of Busch Beer.
I used pressure-treated lumber, and I still have $800 in water damage. How come?
Even treated wood needs Thompson's Water Seal protection.
This patio was supposed to last for years. Now I have $1,200 in damage. Why?
Your concrete wasn't protected with Thompson's Water Seal. Thompson's penetrates into wood, brick, or concrete to form a barrier water can't get past, even when driven by 98-mile-per-hour winds.
Let it rain. This time I use Thompson's, a great defense against repair expense.
Thompson's, the first name in lasting protection.
As we told you earlier, the Baltimore Orioles have won 7 games in a row. They're at first place in the American League East. They will also have the number one draft pick in tomorrow's draft. That's the first time a first-place team has ever done that. It'll likely be Ben McDonald, throws the ball about 99 miles per hour. The Braves will go for a catcher, Tyler Houston. Roger Salcal, the pitcher, 15-0, will go to Seattle.
And maybe some other names you'll be hearing in the draft coming up next. North Carolina against Arkansas, College World Series. I'm Chris Berman.
I'm John Saunders. Thanks for watching.
North Carolina came to the College World Series on an emotional high following their win over Mississippi State in the regional. They started in Omaha with a jolt to top seed Florida State by scoring in their first at bat. But Mike Martin's squad recovered and won a pitcher's duel to send Carolina on its heels. Southwest Conference co-champion Arkansas had a tough task in its opener with Wichita State. But the Razorbacks stayed close thanks to this Greg the Alexander solo homer as they tried to play long ball with one of the country's best. But Wichita State's Greg Brummett shut the door on the Hogs as the Shockers prevailed 3-1. Today, Mike Roberts' Tar Heels face Norm DeBrine's Razorbacks in the first elimination game. We'll see which team will stay alive. For the 40th consecutive year, the College World Series comes from Omaha, Nebraska. This is Rosenblatt Stadium, and for the 10th consecutive year, ESPN covers the best in college baseball. Today, the North Carolina Tar Heels, the number 8 seed in the tournament, take on the 5th-rated Arkansas Razorbacks as both fight for survival on this Sunday afternoon of college baseball. Welcome to Omaha. I'm Bob Carpenter, and it's do or die for the Tar Heels and the Razorbacks, both coming off first-round losses in their ball games on Friday. And Ray Knight, it's a situation now where both ball clubs have to pull out all the stops and do whatever is necessary to win. You don't worry about the next game. You have to survive.
Bob, you're exactly right. They are the type of coaches that are very aggressive, and they're going to do that. All the pitching staff is available today, and they're going to go out and do anything they can to win this ball game because it is a one-game series, as we talked about before.
Let's have a look at how the East looks right now. The East division of the College World Series, Florida State beat North Carolina on Friday, and it'll be Florida State and Wichita State, of course, matching up along with Arkansas and North Carolina after the Shockers beat the Razorbacks. Now we're going to talk a little bit of coaching. We've gathered both of our coaches down on the field here at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha. On your left, Mike Roberts of North Carolina, and on the right, Norm DeBrine of Arkansas. First of all, Mike, in the last hour, you've made 6 changes in your starting lineup. You've moved all but 3 players around. What is your purpose for that going into this ball game?
Well, we feel like that we need to get a little more offense going into today's ball game, and I didn't tell them. I sort of put the normal starting lineup up, and then as we got to the field and approached infield, I decided to make some changes, and we certainly hope there'll be positive changes.
So, Mike, you did not have a team meeting or say anything to this team to motivate them. You talked about the lethargic play on Friday. You didn't say anything to them personally to get them going?
Yes, we did have a very short team meeting. Only a couple statements were made when nothing was said about the lineup until it was posted.
Okay, Mike, thank you very much, and best of luck today. And Norm DeBrine of Arkansas joined us. And Norm, you've obviously been here before, and in a situation like this, what changes for you as far as your approach to this ball game today?
Well, I think basically we're going to have a little more offense on the part of our club, and especially the middle of our lineup. We got to continue to get pitching and defense, and we have some pitching depth, so we feel pretty good about our chances.
Well, that's the question I was going to ask you, Norm. You're going to have to win four ball games now that you're in the loser's bracket, and I wanted to know if you, in fact, felt that you had enough pitching to carry you all the way to the finals.
Well, we feel like that's our strength. We don't have the outstanding All-America type pitcher, but we've got some pitching depth and some quality arms that are in the middle, with specifically Bennett and Hyson, and then a great closer in Phil Stidham. So if we can get on into the tournament, we like our chances.
Norm, thanks for the visit before the ball game today.
Good to see you.
Norm DeBrine of Arkansas, and that's the coaching matchup for today as they try to pull out all the stops and stay alive.
Well, Bob, I think that this is going to be a great ball game. Again, good pitching matchup. You're going to see aggressive baseball today. Guys are going to bunt, hit, and run, and get everything going. So we'll see some exciting baseball.
Razorbacks and the Tar Heels get it on in Omaha on this Sunday of the College World Series. ESPN's presentation of the 1989 NCAA College World Series from Omaha is brought to you by Geo. No matter what you're looking for in a car, it's a Geo. By Diet Coke. Enjoy Diet Coke. You're going to drink it just for the taste of it. It's another windy day in Omaha with the wind blowing in at Rosenblatt Stadium. A day for the pitchers with the Tar Heels and the Razorbacks.
And shut a door and you hear a solid thunk. Also said you won't find a buzz or a rattle. Now doesn't that sound like your kind of car? Geo Prism offer 2.9% GMAC financing or $400 cash back. Plus, if Geo's your first new car, you can get $600 toward your down payment with GMAC financing at select Chevrolet dealers now.
Does your closet crush your clothes till they end up looking like trash? Now get 500% more space with the filing system. Look, 20 hangers normally take up all this room or end up looking like this. But our system separates and organizes hangers. See how much extra space it makes? It's simple. Just hang your clothes on the filing system and file them away. Now when you need them, they're fresh and wrinkle-free. Don't struggle with storing winter clothes. Now you've made enough space for summer and winter wardrobes. There's even a fold-up version for travelers. It packs itself in seconds and then unpacks again with no wrinkles, no worry. They're tough, unbreakable, and normally cost $9.95 each. But we'll send three regular filers, fold-up filer, all for just $9.95. Call now. Use your credit card and call 1-800-544-1000 or send $9.95 plus $3.95 shipping and handling to Filing System, Box 20, Department E, Los Angeles, California. Don't miss this fantastic offer. Call now, 1-800-544-1000.
Head coach Mike Roberts makes his second appearance in Omaha. He is the ACC Coach of the Year. His leadoff man is senior center fielder Tom Nevin. With 8 homers and 40 RBIs, junior left fielder Todd Mitchell. A sophomore, DH, number 3 spot, Brad Woodall. The leading hitter for the Tar Heels at 347 is junior catcher Jesse Levis. With speed in the number 5 spot is junior second baseman Dave Arendis. A sophomore at first base batting 6th, Steve Estroff. A junior at shortstop batting 7th is Ron Maurer. Batting 8th in right field, junior Darren Villani. With a senior at third base batting 9th, Ryan Howison.
Arkansas defense shapes up like this. Senior Scott Pose in right field. Out in center field, outstanding defensive player Don Thomas. Troy Eklund, consensus All-American in left field, a senior. Over in third base, Greg D'Alexander. At shortstop, Rod Stilwell. Second baseman, Tim Thomas. First base, Jim Calhoun. Behind the plate, we have Kurt Tisker, a freshman. And on the mound, we have Dennis Fletcher. Dennis Fletcher is a right-handed pitcher, outstanding command of his pitches, locates his fastball well, but when he needs to throw a strike, he throws that slider. Fastball tails in, slider, big sweeping breaking ball across in the strike zone, and a changeup that fades down and in on that right-handed hitter.
The thing that Norm DeBrien and the Razorbacks like about this right-hander, he usually finds a way to win. He'll have to do that today to keep the Razorbacks alive. A warm day in Omaha. The skies are partly sunny or cloudy, whichever you prefer. Wind a bit of a factor as it blows in from left center, and a 10% chance of rain here at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, where the dimensions are 343 down each line. It's listed as 370, but that's pretty well straight away. 420, it's actually about 380 or so in the power alleys at this ballpark. Umpiring behind the home plate spot this afternoon is Bruce Ravan. He's joined on the bases by Dale Williams, Ron Graham, and Bob Roberts. Razorbacks coming in 50-15, North Carolina 41-17-1. Tom Nevin leads off, and the ball game is underway with ball one down low.
And Bob, Tom Nevin is the catalyst in this ball club. He's really a hustler. Got real strong hands and buggy whips the bat. Hits the ball real hard.
Fastball up and in, and he turned on it in a hurry. Hits it well, but foul. A couple of rows from the top of the seats down the left field side. A ball and a strike.
Well, Mike Roberts says he generates more bat speed than any player on his team, so you can look for him. If Fletcher pitches him inside, he'll turn on that fastball.
Nevin, a 291 hitter, takes the breaking ball in there for a strike. It was high in the strike zone, but dropped in. Dennis Fletcher, a senior, 10-3, also has a save. His appearance of the year, his 15th game credit. Hard breaking ball for the strikeout. So the Razorbacks, right-hander Dennis Fletcher, that first out on the K. Todd Nichols would be the hitter. Mike Roberts, the head coach, over on the third base side with assistant Bobby Gilmore at first.
Well, Fletcher showed you right here. He threw that ball, and you have to stay on that ball. If you're a pull hitter, it's going to be tough to be able to handle that pitch because he's in the plate. And he's
74 after his 0-for-4 against Florida State. This one down low. He is the leading power man at the Tar Heels with a represent over 20% of the North Carolina total homers on the year. Hits the ball well the other way, but right at Rod Stillwell. The younger brother of Kansas City Royals, Scott Kurt Stillwell, no problem with that one.
You see, Rod, one thing about this Arkansas defense, they're the best defensive team in the nation. You see him square up, get right in front of that base. Thing that they do is catch it and throw it, and that's one reason why they're here, combined with their outstanding pitching staff. Impeccable defense in this ball club.
Brad Woodall swings at a breaking ball and hits it hard to right field. Back to the track, and Scott Pons over his head, and with two outs in the second base is Brad Woodall with the double. He turned the right fielder around. Had Pons gotten back to the wall right away, he might have been able to make the catch. But Ray, the toughest ball in baseball is the line drive hit right back over your head.
Well, here it is, Brad Woodall. He just really gets great extension there. He throws him a fastball. Dennis Fletcher throws him a fastball down. Scott Pose turns around because, like you said, Bob, the ball's right at him, and he doesn't pick it up. And the ball was hit so hard, he had no chance to catch it.
A runner goes to scoring position with two down. Jesse Levis will be the hitter.
To Mike Roberts a little bit before the game, and he said that they always talked about bunting and hitting and running, but one thing that he wanted to say was that he talked to his hitters about being more aggressive. Don't play for that one run. We have to go up there and swing the bat.
You play for one run all day, and you might not be playing again. Woodall at second base, two outs, and a fastball from Fletcher was up high. Mike Roberts rotated his lineup, and suddenly here in the first inning, he has the man he'd like to have up there with a man in scoring position. On the fastball, Levis fouls it back, a ball and a strike. Jesse, just an outstanding defensive catcher for Mike Roberts, and also his leading hitter at 347.
Type player that really battles you. Mike said that he's the best overall catcher he's ever had, and you're talking about great catches with Dwight Lowry, Scott Bradley, B.J. Surhoff, but he has the ability to put the ball in play and make contact.
The 1-1 delivery. Fastball up and away, and he was hacking, couldn't reach it. 1-2.
Dennis Fletcher's a compact pitcher, keeps everything, not anything real fast. He just comes right at you, shows you the ball real well, but has late movement on that fastball that tells just a little bit away, and that's what enables him to be effective.
On the 1-2 pitch, it's a breaking ball off speed down in the dirt, blocked by Kirk Fisker. Count goes to 2-2. North Carolina in the ballgame against Florida State on Friday got two of its four hits in the first inning. This almost was another one, but a nice play by Jim Calhoun. Went to his left and saved a run, and the Tar Heels get a double with two outs, but they strand a runner and thus do not score in the top of the first inning on one hit as the Razorbacks are set to come up to the plate. Razorbacks are hitting 306 as a team. The Arkansas lineup is brought to you by Wilson, the official ball of the NCAA College World Series. Leading off, at least from the coaching box, is Norm DeBrine, his 20th year, 700 wins, a four-time Southwest Conference Coach of the Year. His number one man is leading the team in hitting at 392, senior right fielder Scott Pose. A freshman DH batting second is Scott Epps. In left field, batting third, senior Troy Eklund with eight homers on the year. Same for Greg Alexander, a junior third baseman batting fourth, the team leader with 66 RBIs. Batting fifth, the junior first baseman Jim Calhoun. Batting sixth, the freshman catcher, also with eight homers, Kirk Fisker. In the number seven slot, Don Thomas, a senior center fielder. Batting eighth and playing second base, sophomore Tim Thomas. And a senior at shortstop, batting ninth, Rod Stillwell.
And the North Carolina defense, we have out in right field, Darren Villani. Center fielder, Tom Nevin, he's a senior. Todd Nichols, left fielder, is junior. Ryan Howlison, third baseman. Ron Maurer, the shortstop. Dave Arendis over at second base. Steve Estroff, the first baseman. Great catcher, Jesse Levis, behind the plate. And Michael Hogue on the mound. Michael's a left-handed pitcher, 6'1", 200 pounds, features a fastball and sinker, will not overpower you. A steady diet of heavy curveballs with a slower type repertoire. He throws a lot of those breaking balls. He changes speeds on, change-ups and fades away. And he's not the type of pitcher that's going to overpower you, Bob. He just throws a lot of strikes and keeps that offensive hitter off balance.
Well, a good enough athlete that he was named the high school player of the decade in the state of Colorado. Hogue is out of Longmont, Colorado, 6'3". He's listed at 218, but the coaches say that's really not too true. He's pretty wiry for being 6'3". And he was drafted by the Mets out of high school as a hitter. He'll face Scott Pose, the Razorback senior right fielder. Pose hitting a team-leading 392. But the Razorbacks as a team are slumping a bit. They were hitting 320 at the end of the regular season. And since they clinched a tie with Texas A&M for their first Southwest Conference share of the title, they've been hitting 243 in postseason. A big, big breaking ball. Pose trying to bunt it, and the ball bent all over the place on him. Strike one.
We're going to see a lot of those, Bob. He drops down on some of those breaking balls right over top. The breaking ball that goes straight down. He actually throws about three different speeds of breaking ball, and he will not throw fastballs in. You saw it right there, but that was one thing that they said to us, that he will not throw fastballs in. If he throws it in, he throws it in 4 or 5 inches off the plate. There's his motion. He tucks right there good. Shows you that little jerk motion, kind of a three-quarter delivery there that allows him to have good movement.
And a good swing allows Scott Pose to move one up the middle. He was jammed a bit on the pitch, but took it up the middle, and the Razorbacks get their leadoff man aboard. No Razorback fans are out there right now. They're all watching their team bat, but they'll get out there a little bit later, maybe one of those innings when North Carolina is hitting. No matter where Arkansas goes, football, basketball, or college baseball, those Hog supporters are right behind them. Scott Epps, freshman DH, first pitch swinging on a high fastball, fouls it out of the ballpark to the right.
Well, Norm says that Scott Epps is his best young player. He makes very good contact. He's just an average runner, but he likes the ball out over the plate, which may be good because that's exactly where Hogan's going to keep this ball. One thing about Scott Pose at first base,
Although he's leading the team in stolen bases, he is not the type of runner. He's got great speed, but he doesn't get a good jump. And Norm wanted to say that. He's a stolen base career leader at Arkansas, but he doesn't get a good jump. He has to steal the bases by raw speed.
He has a short lead. Now he goes. Grounder left side. That's a fair ball. A nice backhand play by Howison. And an equally nice play by Steve Estroff at first base to shift his feet into foul territory and stay on the bag. Runner ends up at second base with one out.
Great defensive play here. This ball gets by him as possibly a run. He gets over there, keeps his head on the ball. That's one of the most difficult plays because you're going away from first base. You have no idea where it is. You turn and you have to throw the ball immediately when you plant that step. Great play early in the ball game, which could lift this Carolina team up because they are known for that aggressive defense and good play, and that's what keeps you in the ball game right there.
They are also known as a team that doesn't always get great defense from the corners of the infield. That time, Howison and Estroff both did. Here's Troy Eklund. Big breaking ball. He foul tipped it. Looks like Michael Hoke took a little bit off that breaking pitch. Eklund hitting 321 with 8 homers and 61 runs batted in. Hawks have 3 8 homer hitters in their lineup.
Well, they certainly do. They are a good hitting ball club, and this is their best hitter. He's the type of guy that likes to pull the ball, but is a situational hitter and will go the other way when a guy will not throw a pitch his middle end. He does like the fastball from middle of the plate end, preferably down, but he has learned to hit. He's gotten better and better as the year's gone on, Norm says, and has learned to hit the ball to right field when the pitcher throws him away.
Scott Pose at second with one out. Tar Heels had a man at second with two outs, could not deliver. 0-2 to Eklund, who looks at one low and outside as Hoke shows him the fastball.
Well, we're going to see a lot of that pitch right there. When he throws the fastball, he turns it over away. He uses the outside part of that plate and uses the outside inch or two of that plate and tries to set you up and goes more and more away with you. Then he throws that tantalizing slow curveball that's very tough to time.
Second baseman Dave Arendis in behind Scott Pose.
Shot at Mike Roberts right there.
Off-speed pitch in the dirt, swing and a miss. They'll have to run it out and make the throw to first base. Jesse Levis was checking the runner at second as he went into his throwing motion. Strikeout number one for Michael Hogue.
Michael Hogue is not going to blow the ball by you. All he's going to do is set you up with off-speed pitches. You see that ball bounces about 5 inches in front of the plate. Good arm motion, but he throws his best fastball is about 81 miles an hour. So as a hitter, you must go up there, give him the inside part of the plate, hit the ball to right field and adjust. And that's what this Arkansas team is going to have to do, is hit the ball to right center field if they're going to do anything with this guy.
Greg the Alexander takes the fastball outside. His first time up there. And it really helps if you have a Jesse Levis behind the plate because pitchers are not afraid to throw that ball in the dirt. You saw Jesse knock it down and keep the strikeout in order and the runner where he was. Left side, Howison charges. And the inning is over. Each team with a hit in the first inning. Each team stranding a runner. And already we're seeing good defense. At the top of the first inning, Jim Calhoun picked one off for Arkansas to save a run. And in this inning, Ryan Howison and Steve Estroff teaming up for the Tar Heels. Scoreless after one.
Once again, it's time to send a message to the Capitol. Let them read your lips.
That's right, Mr. Congressman. Read my lips. We want no gun control laws. The Constitution guarantees every American the right to bear arms, and in these high crime times when every decent family is threatened by stick-ups and break-ins, rape and muggings, nobody's going to take away my right to protect my loved ones, my home, and my property. Who are these people who want to scrap the Constitution? Vote for America. Vote no to gun control laws.
We say guns should be outlawed. This isn't the 1880s, and we don't live in the Wild West. Only the police need guns, not ordinary citizens. Guns kill too many people and innocent animals, too. They should be outlawed. So vote for a kinder, gentler society. Vote yes for gun control laws.
Do you want gun control? Call 1-900-490-6351 to vote no. Or call 1-900-490-6352 to vote yes. Vote now, just $2 per call. When polling is completed, the results will be tallied and promptly delivered to Congress. Make your vote count. Call now.
Welcome back to Rosenblatt Stadium, Omaha. It's Game 5 of the College World Series with North Carolina tangling with Arkansas. The Tar Heels, the number 8 seed. The Razorbacks are number 5. With Ray Knight, Bob Carpenter at the ballpark as we get ready for the second inning with Dave Arendis to lead off for the Tar Heels. Arendis, a 239 hitter, a couple of homers and 28 batted in. He's the number one runner on this team. The Tar Heels haven't stolen a whole lot of bases this year. In fact, their percentage isn't that great either. 57 steals, 40 caught stealing. But Arendis, a guy who can do some running if he gets on, and he's worked the count to 2-0.
Well, Mike says that he's the most fluid, natural athlete on his ball club, but he must keep the ball out of the air. He has a tendency to uppercut, and he's a ground ball line drive hitter when he's going well, so you can look for that. If he starts hitting the ball in the air, he's not swinging or on his game.
Well hit left field. A rocket for a base hit. Troy Eklund up with it. And when you look at what happened in the first inning, Ray, three very well-hit balls by the Tar Heels. Two of them were outs with a double in between, and now another shot. Dennis Fletcher is off to a bit of a shaky start.
And I think a lot of that has to do with Mike Roberts' philosophy today. You going up there, we're going to make things happen, not only by bunting and hitting and running and moving the runners, but swinging the bats. There's been a lot of talk about this team. If they get behind three or four runs, they can't beat you. And he says that that creates a negative type feeling about a ball club. So he wants to come out and show people that he can score runs and be aggressive with the bats.
Has to be pleased with the way his guys are swinging so far. Fastball up, runner going, throw is high and late. Ron Graham letting the country know the runner was safe. Number 13 for Dave Arendis.
Well, you mentioned Arendis being a good base stealer. What's right here? First move right there, he's right off. A great jump, throws that hand and gets himself going, runs real good straight up. He's in there easily. Gets a great jump on the pitcher right there. That base was stolen on the pitcher. Here he is going in head first. A lot of these guys slide head first. They think they get to the base quicker, but he's in there easily.
Runner at second, nobody out. Estroff now wants to move that runner around. He'll do it on a grounder up the middle. To his left, nice play by Rod Stillwell. Over to third goes Arendis with one out.
Well, that's what you call textbook baseball, Bob. You know that. He steals a base. The next hitter tries to pull the ball. Estroff, not really a pull hitter. He hits the ball all over the field, but the second runner at second baseman, Dave Arendis, knowing that the ball hit anywhere at him or behind him, he's taken off for third base. Now you have that situation with runner on third base, less than two outs, and great opportunity for North Carolina to get ahead in this ballgame.
Ron Mauer with 23 runs batted in. Greg DeAlexander is in close at third as Dennis Fletcher fakes a pickoff throw to that side. They're deep at the other infield position, so the Razorbacks here early in the game will concede the run to get the out. Squeeze bunt, and the catcher misses it, Kirk Pisker. The ball had some funny spin on it. He looked up and thought he had it, and he may have put his big catcher's mitt between his eyes and the ball and lost sight of it.
That's a great observation, Bob. That happens one time. You see, it's that breaking ball breaking away, and he just stabs at it. He looks up. Should have been an easy play for him, but you're exactly right. That's exactly what happened. He couldn't see the ball because the catcher's mitt is between the ball and his eyes. That's a great observation.
But not a very good play. They will give an error on the catcher. So the normally reliable Razorback defense with a rare mistake. The only good thing about that for Arkansas is strike one, and Fletcher is ahead of the hitter. Ron Mauer has to be standing at home plate figuring, I've got to take advantage of this second chance. Good scoop by Kirk Pisker.
Arkansas defense there may be a little different than North Carolina. They're going to concede this run knowing that they can score runs. North Carolina in this situation, if it comes up a little later, you'll notice that they play their infielders a little closer trying to cut that run down in home plate.
Breaking ball, well hit to left field. Troy Eklund is back on the track, and he's got it for the sacrifice fly. Scoring is Arendis. Yesterday and today, that ball does not get out of the ballpark. On Friday, it would have. A long sack fly for Mauer, and the Tar Heels lead 1-0.
Fletcher going to the breaking ball here and gets it right out over the plate. Just hangs it right there for him to nail. That ball hangs in there. It never moves over the plate. Sits right there in that power zone. And that's a tough pitch to swing and miss right there, Bob. Your eyes just light up on that ball. And with the wind blowing in, had it not been blowing in, that ball had a chance probably.
Aaron Villani, the hitter, jammed on a bunt, lays a good one down. Fletcher pounces and makes the throw. So the Tar Heels get Arendis, the leadoff man, aboard with a single and a steal. And then two outs later, he scores on the sacrifice fly by Ron Mauer. We've played an inning and a half here in Omaha. The North Carolina Tar Heels have outhit the Arkansas Razorbacks by a score of 2-1. And they lead it 1-0 in this game for survival.
Last week, us Fritos wrestlers came upon a whole new breed, ranch Fritos. They looked real wild, but they was actually sort of mild. Shoot, one even let Luke pet it. These wild and mild ranch Fritos have a creamy ranch flavor. No Fritos wrestler can resist. But keep that under your hat, partner. New wild and mild ranch flavor Fritos corn chips. Rustle up some.
I'll show you a morning like you've never seen. I'll show you a land where there's still to dream.
Come on, haven't you always wanted to run away to the South Pacific? Well, now you can with Qantas.
I call Australia home.
No one flies more people to Australia and the South Pacific than Qantas.
It's the ultimate test of racing endurance. Saturday, see the spectacular start. And Sunday, the dramatic conclusion of the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Live on ESPN.
Tar Heels have taken the lead in both their ball games here in Omaha. They've had the early lead. Couldn't hold on against Florida State. Now the Razorbacks will go to the plate. Bottom of the second inning, and Jim Calhoun. The Razorbacks are 20-14 when they do not score first. 50 wins on the year for Norm DeBryan and his Razorbacks. Pretty good off-speed breaking pitch, low and away, 0-2.
You see right there, Jim Calhoun chased that ball, and Norm DeBryan said he was a very aggressive hitter and had a fluid swing, but he hasn't hit much, and his tendency is to chase bad pitches. Although he makes a lot of contact, he's only struck out six times. He tends to hit those pitches that are off the plate and put them in play.
Down and away with a sinker.
Said he had very good hand-eye coordination, Bob, and that he made a lot of contact, but he just needs to be more selective at the plate.
Breaking ball, and he nicely took it to the right side. Calhoun waited on that pitch, did not try to pull it, and the Razorbacks have their second hit of the game. Looks like we may be in for a bit of an offensive show here this afternoon, the way both teams are swinging.
Well, that's the way you're going to have to hit Michael Hoge. You're going to have to take the fastball in, which he's not going to do anything but show to you. He's a type of pitcher like the Mike Caldwells or Randy Jones. He shows you pitches in and tries to get you out with pitches away. That slow breaking ball is a type pitch you can't try to pull. You have to stay on it and hit right field or right center.
First pitch swinging, Kurt Fisker pops it up. Dave Arendis in short right field will take it. One out. Fisker approaching you there, hit by a pitch recently and had some bones broken up around his left eye. Back in the lineup and catching. One on, one out. Senior center fielder Don Thomas, the hitter, as you surveyed the situation from upstairs. Thomas, a 191 hitter. The bats are ringing here this afternoon. Thomas not having a very good year, but he did have one of the year's biggest hits for Arkansas, a homer against Arizona State that got them to the regional final against Lemoyne. That was the only run scored in a 1-0 win over the Sun Devils.
Well, he's the best athlete on this ball team. He was highly recruited as a college football player, so he could do a lot of things well. And a note also, Norm said that he was his third baseman in 1985 World Series, so he's been around a long time, and they moved him to the outfield to take advantage of that speed.
Don Thomas out of Pine Bluff. They've got the runner picked off. Calhoun.
Sure.
safe at second base. A high throw from Estrom, and Runmauer, the shortstop, had to sky to reach it. Jim Calhoun stealing second.
Mike Hoag does not have a good move, and they know that. He's going to take off on the first move. As soon as he picks that foot up, he goes on the first move, taking a chance. He throws home, and that puts a lot of pressure on a first baseman. He has to make a good throw, throwing right down the back of that runner. It's a very aggressive play from Arkansas.
Off-speed pitch in the dirt, a ball and a strike to Don Thomas. Jim Calhoun singled to lead off the inning. Then the steal of second. To the right, one and two.
See Jim Calhoun going straight to the base right here and slides in straight to the base. That's what they teach a base stealer. Straight line. He went straight from first base, straight to second base, and slid in there and did not lose any time because he was directly in line with that bag. One thing to know as a first baseman there, if you can pick a guy off, you have to step way toward the inside, toward the grass side of the infield, and throw the ball inside. He did that, but he threw the ball high.
Don Thomas, who has struggled against the breaking ball in the past, seeing a steady diet of such pitches. Michael Hoag calling that one off. The count stays a ball and two strikes. Hoag is 3-4 on the year with an ERA of 3.73. Opponents have hit .244 against him this year. It's his 16th appearance and start. Not a guy who goes the distance a whole lot. He's only done that once in 15 starts. As he gets ready to grip the 1-2 pitch.
That's a four-seamer, so it looks like a fastball.
That's a fair ball into the corner. The Razorbacks have tied the game, digging for second in Thomas, and he's there with a one-out RBI double.
As you saw the grip right there, usually when a pitcher grips that ball across the big seams, he's going to throw a fastball, especially the guy Mike Hoag's, a breaking ball pitcher. He's going to try to get some type of seam on his fingers. Right there, you saw the ball right there with his fingers across the big seams, which is called a four-seamer. He tried to run that pitch away, fastball away, and Don Thomas went right with it. The ball moved over the plate a little bit, and he hit that ball real hard.
One run in, one out. Don Thomas with that big homer against Arizona State we told you about, then that double may be hitting the heaviest 191 in the country right now. Here's Tim Thomas, the sophomore second baseman. A bouncer about 4 feet out in front of the plate, and a nice play by Jesse Levis on that 56-footer, a ball and a strike.
There you see the grip again. He grips it with the seam, so that should be a fastball or a turned over changeup, which sometimes he'll have that big part of the ball and he can get more rotation going away. A screwball pitcher will grip the ball like that, but if he's going to throw a curveball or breaking ball, he usually grips it with the seam.
Breaking ball down and in. Thomas takes it, ball three.
One thing about Tim Thomas is that he always works the count, Norm says, and he gets a lot of pitches, sees a lot of pitches. He's a good contact hitter, hits a lot of balls to right center field.
Breaking ball that registers in the high 60s. In rural areas, that's only 3 over the speed limit. So with one out and a runner at second, the count stays 3-2. They'll let you get away with that most of the time. At second base, Don Thomas, who had an RBI double a moment ago. Razorbacks have now out-hit Carolina 3-2. Trying to take the lead. Breaking ball outside, ball four. First walk issued by Michael Hoag.
That shows Tim Thomas's patience right there. That ball is a backdoor breaking ball, and he laid off of it. That shows his ability to work the count and get a good pitch to hit.
Thomas and Thomas aboard. Don and Tim. Rod Stillwell, the hitter.
Well, Rod has become a real good hitter this year. He struggled a little bit with the bat early in his career, and he's a guest hitter. He gets fooled a lot, but he's worked hard in his game and has become a good hitter.
Fastball, well hit, right center. Over to get it, Darren Villani. One-handed grab and the throw to the relay man. Into third base goes Don Thomas. That ball looked like it had extra base hit possibilities, but it died out there, and Villani got over in good fashion to make the play. Two down.
hit to right center. Derek Villani knows that the wind's bringing the ball back to him. He gets there, turns, sets himself up, gets himself, takes that big crow hop and comes in and guns the ball to the shortstop for the cutoff man.
Runners at the corners with two down. And if the Razorbacks are to take the lead, it'll be up to Scott Pose, who singled up the middle his first time. Lefty against lefty, a 400 hitter so far in Omaha. Big breaking ball, strike one. Ryan Howison in very close at third.
Scott Pose does not bunt very much. There's something on him, but you notice his North Carolina defense is right on top of him.
On a breaking ball, it's popped up left side. Ron Mauer, the shortstop, wants it. And the Razorbacks inning is over. But Arkansas, in the bottom of the second inning, gets a run on two hits. Jim Calhoun and Don Thomas teaming up. A walk later, they strand two. They've left three. On to the third inning we go. Game five of the College World Series, tied 1-1.
A 1990 Geo Prism is filled with things like storage pockets, console trays, even a special cup holder. Yet there's still plenty of room left over for your important things. Geo! And here's a special Geo Prism offer. 2.9% GMAC financing or $400 cash back. Plus, if Geo's your first new car, you can get $600 toward your down payment with GMAC financing at select Chevrolet dealers now.
It's ever so tough being ranked number one and not being rank. Playing the game without getting gamey. What assists me is Right Guard Sport Stick from Gillette with its maximum protection and aromatically airy scents. It's the essence of good gamesmanship. After all, when one is capable of home runs, why play foul? Right Guard Sport Stick, deodorant, and antiperspirant. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Welcome back to Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha. From the first base side, the view of this field, a 1-1 score with the Tar Heels and Razorbacks even after two innings of play. Top of the third, bottom of the order for the Heels, Ryan Howison, senior third baseman, hitting 211, is the leadoff man. Breaking ball in there, a ball and a strike. Howison, a guy on the North Carolina team who started on the junior varsity, worked his way to the big club, fouling it off, the ball and two strikes. LSU in Long Beach State. Losers bracket game coming up tomorrow at 5 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. 49ers and the Tigers. There's a fastball on the outside corner. Strikeout number two for Dennis Fletcher. Nothing fancy there. Great location, partner.
Well, he locates well, and he gets him looking right there. I don't know. He's just looking for the breaking ball, and he freezes that fastball right down the middle. That's the only thing that you can say about that. He's throwing a lot of breaking balls, and he threw the fastball right down the middle. And the only way a hitter freezes in that pitch is if he's looking for a breaking ball or something soft.
Tom Nevin fanned his first time.
Something we might want to mention here. Tony Gilmore is the number one catcher for Arkansas, but Kirk Pisker is the personal catcher for Dennis Fletcher.
Big breaking ball, 0-2.
He's caught him in all of his starts this year, and they seem to work real good together. Both very, very intense competitors, and that's one thing that they said about Dennis Fletcher. As you mentioned, he finds a way to win, but he's a great competitor, and Kirk Pisker adds to that with his aggressiveness.
78-mile-an-hour breaking ball for the strikeout. Two Ks in the inning and three in the game.
You see the fastball striking the hitter out prior to this, and here comes that slider, late breaking slider. See that late break right there? And he just fools him with the break on that ball. Dennis Fletcher has the outstanding ability to locate that slider for a strike. We mentioned earlier that when he has to throw a strike, 2-0 or 2-1 or 3-1, he's just as apt to throw that slider as any other pitch.
Todd Nichols lined hard to short his first time. Fastball is down low. Todd Nichols wearing an 0 for 5 collar so far. Tar Heels only had four hits in that 4-2 loss to Florida State here on Friday, but Nichols answers with a ringing single up the middle. the kind of pitch and hit that makes a guy like Dennis Fletcher glad the ball was not a little bit lower coming through the bat, the pitching box. That one was really
Pisker sets up outside, and the ball is right to his glove, and he just jumps right on it right there. Todd Nichols, good hitter, good extension, hits the ball all over the ballpark. That fastball was on the outside part of the plate, and he hit it right where it was pitched.
One on, two out. Brad Woodall. Looks like he took a little bit off that pitch, and Woodall, who doubled his first time, couldn't make contact.
Well, there's no question about this North Carolina offense coming out here aggressive, Bob. They're swinging at the first pitch, or the first pitch that looks like a strike to them, very aggressively. They've had very strong, good, aggressive hacks today, and they're going just according to what Mike talked about.
Breaking ball down, runner going, throw is there. That dropped. Perfect throw by Kirk Pisker right on the bag. Stillwell got there as the runner did and could not hold on.
But there you see Todd Nichols lumbering down there. He's not a good runner. He got a decent jump. They roll the dice again here. The play is there. Only thing right there is he just doesn't get there, set, catch the ball, and tag him. He tried to do it all at one time. He had plenty of time to catch that ball and put the tag down. He tried to. Looked like he got a little cute with that to me, Bob. One thing he talked about before the game with Norm, he said that Rod has a tendency, he's a great, great fielding shortstop, but he has a tendency a lot of times to do things and not get in front of the ball, to do things like a lot of the Latin shortstops by reaching out and catching the ball and doing things, and that was an example of that.
1-2 pitch, fastball grounded to the shortstop. Stillwell stays with it. Looks like he's got the same kind of arm his older brother does, a gun over to first base. A single with two down and the steal. The Tar Heels leave a runner, they've stranded two. On to the bottom of the third, the Razorbacks and the Heels, each with three hits and each with one run.
One of the great advantages of doing business with a firm like Schwab is that you're dealing with professionals across the whole country. They're creating financial advantages for the individual investor.
I can't say which is better, the Schwab computer system or the Schwab people. But there's no doubt being backed up by the industry's most automated system gives our brokers a tremendous advantage.
You know, investors are smart. They know what they want and they know what to look for. Schwab doesn't try to sell them anything. I think it's a refreshing change from the usual. I mean, who would have ever imagined a brokerage firm without commissioned salespeople?
I tell people, come in and see us. If you need to talk to us face to face, we're here. That's why we have so many branches.
For a free booklet describing Schwab services, call toll-free 800-873-6400. That's 800-873-6400. Call Schwab today.
You might have the impression that you can use drugs and alcohol and still be at your best. In fact, some people claim that drugs and alcohol help them to perform better in school, at work, in sports, or just helping them to get through the day. But you can see where those people really end up, hooked and helpless. Drugs and alcohol don't pave the way to success. They're nothing but a dead end.
This message furnished by the NCAA.
We're going to see on supervision here the movement of Hogue's curveball. Thomas, he's throwing to Don Thomas here. The last 15 feet of this ball, you see the break there, and that's what he has to do to be effective. He has to throw that breaking ball that drops straight down off the table, as you see right there on the supervision, the great drop in that ball and the movement down.
Scott Epps, the leadoff man for the Razorbacks in the third. Hit a ball to the left side, right down the line, and Ryan Howison went backhand to throw him out. That was with a runner aboard in the first inning. The Hawks have threatened in both innings so far. They scored a run on two hits and a walk in the second inning. One of our best young players is what Norm DeBrien says about Scott Epps. DHing as a freshman with Rod Stillwell, a senior, he could be the shortstop a year from now. Junior left-hander Michael Hogue. The breaking ball at the knees on the outside corner. Scott Epps stooping over and looking at that one as if, how could I possibly reach that pitch?
Bob, this is a backdoor breaking ball that starts on the outside part of the plate, and the hitter gives up on it with that great rotation. It comes down. Watch this pitch right here, startling outside part of the plate. He sets up outside, and the ball just loops around that strike zone, and the ball's over the plate. But you give up on that pitch because you see it so well outside, but that rotation brings the ball back in on the corner of that plate.
Troy Eklund fan swinging his first time. That was strikeout number two for Michael Hoge. Well hit. Up the middle, no chance for Ron Mauer. And the Razorbacks have their fourth base hit. Eklund came in hitting 321. One for two in this game. And they love to see him get aboard ahead of Greg D. Alexander, who's their big RBI man. Back between them, Eklund and Alexander have driven home 127 runs this year. Breaking ball. Greg takes it down low. You know, that's what makes Scott Bryant's 107 for Texas so impressive. You put these two guys together and say, hey, 127 between two guys. That's a lot. 107 from one guy?
That is a tremendous accomplishment. Those Texas guys get on base, but that's just a great ability, as you said, struck out 23 times during the season to put the ball in play with runners in scoring position consistently.
Runner going, the Alexander takes it to second. Nice throw by Levis, and the runner surpassed the bag. Eklund had it stolen and then slid past second base.
Eklund, good base runner, gets a good jump, head down, running for that bag. He's there easily, but he slides a little late. See, he slides and hits the bag immediately with his foot and goes on by the bag and can't get back. Just slid a little late.
Eklund gets the steal, then four unassisted on the putout.
You see it again, he slides right there, 2 feet from the bag, and there's no way that he can stop because his momentum takes him right on by the bag.
On a changeup, the Alexander way out ahead of it. Two balls and two strikes. So now the base is empty with two down. We've seen some good throws by both catchers in this game. Well hit into left center, but the wind will knock it down, and Tom Nevin waits for it. So it turns into your basic 1-2-3 inning. A hit for the Razorbacks. The runner lost after the steal. Nobody stranded. After three, Arkansas's out hit Carolina 4-3 in a 1-1 ball game.
Give your kids the competitive edge in their favorite sports with America's best selection of instructional sports videos, only from ESPN. Regularly $39.95, now just $29.95 each if you call 1-800-554-9000. Top coaches in basketball, football, baseball, soccer, and tennis teach your kids the basics and help them develop a lifelong love for the sports and a winning attitude. Now on video cassettes, your kids can play again and again. Just $29.95 each and only from ESPN Home Video. Coaches like University of Arizona's Jerry Kindle show your kids how to improve their game and add to their fun. This 75-minute video cassette demonstrates winning fundamentals of fielding, hitting, pitching, catching, and sliding. $29.95 never lets you do so much for a kid. Call 1-800-554-9000 for teaching kids baseball or your free catalog of videos only from ESPN Home Video.
The overhead view of supervision shows you the movement in and out. Ryan Hallison's at the plate. Fletcher throws him a slider away, and you can see this is from the overhead angle looking down, and that's the way the ball tracks. See how far that ball moved outside, way outside the strike zone, but at one time, about 7 or 8 feet in front of that plate, that ball was on the outside part of the plate, and it fooled Hallison.
Top of the fourth, 1-1. Jesse Levis will lead off for the Tar Heels. He rips a fastball to center field. Don Thomas back, and the wind helps hold that one up. Caught about 20 feet in front of the 420 mark out there. So the conditions continue to favor the pitchers here, even on well-hit balls at Rosenblatt Stadium.
Well, he turns around and looks for the ball. He knows the wind's going to knock it down, so he starts to slowing down because he knows he doesn't have to go any farther. If anything there, sometimes outfielders overrun the ball. He heard the crack of the bat, knew the ball was hit real hard, turned around, but with his knowledge and preparing before the play, he knew that that ball was dying, so he did a great job on that ball. That ball was smoked, Bobby. That ball had to be off the wall without that wind, but that wind is really knocking the ball down.
Averend is singled. Stolen scored his first time, a ball and a strike to him. You know, you talk about the flight of the ball off the bat, but on that play, the pitch is also significant. Fletcher challenged him with a fastball, provided some of the power for the hitter, who then hit the ball very well, and it still didn't get out. That tells you the pitchers will be able to go with the fastball. They want to challenge the hitters and work to the big part of this park on a day like this. Breaking ball up high, ball three.
The type of wind we have right now is in from left center field blowing to the right field line. Any ball hit is going to be knocked down. If you hit it to left field, the rotation is going to knock the ball down. Center field is going to knock it back toward the infield, and to right field it's going to knock it down toward the line. So I don't hardly see how any ball can go out of this ballpark right now, Bob.
Well, there's Fletcher on 3-1, not afraid to challenge the hitter with a fastball. What will he do on 3-2? Breaking ball popped up. Center fielder Don Thomas takes it, 2 down. Good looking athlete out there. Ray talked about it a few minutes ago, and he was at the plate and got a big RBI double. Those Razorback fans are all over the place. There are a lot of campers outside, trailers with the Hog logo on them. Up here in Omaha, where with 2 outs in the top of the fourth inning, Steve Estroff will be the hitter. Grounded to short his first time and takes a breaking ball for a strike.
And he grounded to short in a situation when he had to get the runner over. Good piece of hitting sometimes. That 6-3 doesn't look like much, but he got the runner over and allowed that run to get in.
Out of play, left side. You can see the gray skies in the background. Cloudy day in Omaha. Forecast could be for temperatures in the 50s overnight here. Chopper right side. English will take it foul. There's a souvenir for a young man on the third base side. Estroff back from a right hamstring pull that kept him out of the Carolina Invitational that you saw on ESPN a couple of weeks ago. 0-2 pitch. And this one, too, will go foul. Mike Roberts joking with us here today called it a pretty bad hamstring pull for a guy who doesn't run very well.
Yeah, he said, I didn't know you could pull a hamstring when you ran that slowly.
He did. You know, North Carolina using Jesse Levis today in the number 4 spot. Estroff has hit there in the past. They've used 14 different, quote, cleanup men this year. They don't really call them cleanup men. They call them number 4 hitters when they put on the Carolina blue.
See, the catcher set up away, his fastball away there.
That's where he put it. And this one will get out of play. Today, foul balls will drift into the seats because the wind is working with the ball to push it back. On a normal day, the big area in foul territory here at Rosenblatt Stadium will give the infielders better chances to make putouts. Not many will come twisting back in today.
Well, Bob, it'd be interesting to see what he's going to do right here. 2 pitches, 0-2, he's gone away with him. And he's fought those balls off. He's got a quick slider that he can throw for strikes. Let's see if he tries to bust him in with that slider and get him to chase a pitch down and in.
Breaking ball in the dirt. You saw the young man with the Kansas City cap on a moment ago. Omaha's Royals, the AAA affiliate of the Kansas City Royals.
That's what a pitcher will do a lot of times. He'll show you a couple pitches away, but those are just pitches he's setting you up with, and then he's going to come back and try to get you with his out pitch, which is a slider. And even against left-handed hitters, out pitch is his slider.
There it is, down low, strikeout number 4. And a 1-2-3 inning for Dennis Fletcher and the Arkansas Razorbacks. Middle of the 4th. It's a 1-1 score, the elimination game in Omaha.
The 1990 Geo Prism is so well built, there are only 4 parts its bumper-to-bumper plus 3-year 50,000-mile warranty doesn't cover. And those 4 parts come with their own warranty. Geo!
And here's a special Geo Prism offer. 2.9% GMAC financing or $400 cash back. Plus, if Geo's your first new car, you can get $600 toward your down payment with GMAC financing at select Chevrolet dealers now.
Tennis. The French Open. Tomorrow. Live on ESPN.
ESPN here in Omaha for the 10th consecutive year of College World Series action from Rosenblatt Stadium. Today, it's Game 5 as North Carolina takes on Arkansas. As we go to the bottom of the fourth inning, 1-1.
Well, here you see Mike Hogue, and you have Scott Epps hitting. Scott Epps takes this pitch. Right there is an out breaking ball that starts an outside part of the plate, and he's frozen. Now, here's our shot on supervision. And this is a side angle, and you see the pitch coming in here, and you see that movement, the breaking ball in the last 15 feet, how that ball moves down and back in on the plate. You can't see the movement in, but that's how much that ball moves down.
Jim Calhoun leading off the bottom of the fourth for the Razorbacks. Leading off the second inning, this 218 hitter took one through the right side for a base hit, stole second, scored on a double by Don Thomas. Interesting inning that second was for the Razorbacks as a 218 hitter and a 191 hitter teamed up to get the two hits for the run. A ball and a strike. Breaking ball. Cool cue shot to the right side. He hit it right off the top of the bat. Not the end of the bat, the top of the bat. 1-2. First base umpire Dale Williams, the crew chief here in Omaha, will have a look. Michael Hogue has shown good control so far.
And a lot of what they call slop in the major leagues. He's just throwing that ball up there and just letting it fall off the table, whether it be the breaking ball or that changeup or that little what we call a dead fish fastball. Dead fish fastball is when a pitcher throws the ball 78, 79 miles an hour, starts about knee high and just kind of falls out of the strike zone, but it's very tough for a hitter to lay off. And what happens, Bob, you have a tendency to start looking for that pitch and swinging for bad pitches away.
Showing him the fastball away, ball two, it's 2-2. Two-two pitch, he literally throws his bat at the ball and fouls one into the bullpen.
It's tough to hit that pitch solidly. The only way that you can really do it is kind of close your stance, maybe move off the plate and make sure that you're almost diving into that ball, especially if a guy does not have enough heat or velocity inside to get you.
Outside, ball three. Full count, Calhoun, followed by Kirk Fisker and Don Thomas. Three, two. Breaking ball, well hit right center. This one will plug the gap. Calhoun digging for two, and he might go for three. Takes them a long time to get it in. It's a sliding triple to lead off the fourth inning.
Center field, what we just set up. Here's a pitch out over the plate, outside part of the plate, and Calhoun stays right on that ball and drives it to right center field. That's a picture book way of hitting that ball. You must stay right on top of it. Never stops running, rounds the base, looks at his third base coach. He's got the sign. He's going all the way to third base with nobody out.
Breaking ball swung on and fouled by Fisker. Ray, you've made the comment earlier in the World Series of outfielders playing shallow. Well, that's fine for fly balls, but on balls to the gap, we'll start to see some three base hits if the wind continues like it is here. That's the first triple of the College World Series.
Well, any ball hit that low line drive, you're right, Bob. They don't have enough time to make up that angle. When the ball gets by them, it's going to be a triple.
RBI opportunity for Fisker. Swing and a miss. 0-2. Fisker Powell popped up to the right side his first time.
Shot of the infield right there. As we mentioned before, Carolina does not want to give up a run, and all their infielders are on the grass with nobody out, which is very unusual. Most of the time early in the ball game, they'll at least be halfway or back and concede that run. But in this situation, they're going to try to get this run at the plate. And as you saw earlier, Norm DeBrien played his infield back. So it's two different philosophies.
70% strikes from Michael Hoge until that fastball outside. Hit by a pitch recently was Fisker. In midseason, he was hit right around the left eye and had fractured bones around that eye. There's a nasty breaking ball down and in, and the strikeout.
Michael Hoge has to rely on the break and the movement of that breaking ball, and here's that slider that he gets on top of real good, and that movement down and in. Very tough pitch for a right-handed hitter to hit. Here's a swing, but you have to really get out front to hit that breaking ball, and to hit it, you hit it foul. That ball almost disappears in there. It's a Steve Carlton-type pitch, certainly not with the velocity, but with the same type bite.
Don Thomas with another RBI chance. Suicide squeeze. The bunt is good, and Arkansas scores.
Norm DeBrien knows that Michael Hoge is right around the plate, sends a runner right here, suicide squeeze. The runner takes off on the first movement, and that's why he's safe at home. That was not a safety squeeze. The runner moved on the first movement from the left hander and allowed him to get in there safely. Here it is again. The ball's down and away, a bad pitch, but suicide squeeze, you must put the bat on the ball, and that's exactly what he did. Great play.
Not a bad play by the pitcher, Michael Hoge, coming in and scooping with the glove. But it was not a close play at the plate. And two RBIs today for Don Thomas.
And the point I made, a lot of times coaches will have a runner come off third base. Look at this scoop right here. He makes a great play, great effort right there. And had the runner not started, as soon as the pitcher started his motion, he'd have had a chance to get him at home.
Right side, left side, base hit. Tim Thomas. So the Razorbacks now with a couple of hits around the suicide squeeze fielder's choice in the inning. And they still have something going with runners at first and second and one out. Arkansas on top 2-1. Down to the number nine man, Rod Stillwell, the hitter. Well, the law firm of Thomas & Thomas doing the job today. Hit on base twice each. Don and Tim. Stillwell hits a double play ball. Batted down by Maurer, and a good play at second base by Dave Arendis. They go 6-4-3 on a ball hit sharply. But in the bottom of the fourth inning, the Razorbacks take the lead. They get a run on two hits, a suicide squeeze figured in. And after four innings of play, the Razorbacks have out-hit the Tar Heels 6-3 and lead 2-1.
Official title is head of auto testing for Consumer Reports magazine, but I really work for you.
And there are over 200 people who work for you at Consumer Reports. We test and report on everything from toothpaste to TVs.
Right now is a good time to try Consumer Reports because you can get a free trial issue with no strings attached.
Here are the details.
Call now for your free trial issue of Consumer Reports, the magazine that gives you all the pros and cons of a product, including price. Call for your free trial issue now, then decide. When the bill arrives, pay it and get 11 more issues, 12 in all, including the annual buying guide issue, for just $18. Or write cancel on the bill and owe nothing. If you do subscribe, you'll also get two free gifts, the New Medicine Show, updated and revised, and the 1989 buying guide issue.
So put Consumer Reports to work for you. Call now.
Call now for Consumer Reports.
Call 1-800-544-1000. 1-800-544-1000.
Top of the fifth inning, Arkansas with a run. In the fourth inning, after their single run in the second, Both players teaming up. Calhoun has scored two runs. Don Thomas has driven him home twice. And the Hogs on top, 2-1, top of the fifth inning, with the bottom of the North Carolina batting order due up. Ron Mauer, the shortstop, will lead off. Four in a row now, retired by Dennis Fletcher. He's also retired 9 of the last 10 hitters. So the Tar Heel bats have gone a bit quiet here as we move into the middle of the ballgame. Mauer hit the ball hard and a long way last time with a left field wall sacrifice fly.
Those bats going quiet have a lot to do with that. Fletcher starting to locate that breaking ball.
Fastball in, fly ball left field. Well hit, carrying to the trap. And caught right in front of the fence by Troy Eklund. A fly ball that was hit high enough that the wind finally got a hold of it and knocked it down. But another home run bit for Ron Mauer.
Well, he jumps all over the ball. The fastball was in. He got the bat head very much out front. And as you see, the ball is probably over the fence at one time and just moves back. The outfielder can drift on balls like that. You talk about not drifting, but he's drifting on that ball because it's coming back toward that infield.
Darren Villani, the hitter. Fastball got inside on him into right field, and it'll bloop in for a hit. Scott Post saw the hitter take that big swing, and it hit him on the fist and dunked into right field.
And Bob, as we talked about, the wind kept the ball out of the ballpark to left field. The wind knocked that ball down to right field and allowed him to get a base hit because it's blowing a little bit from left to right field.
One on, one out. Ryan Howison, the hitter. You might have seen the number 9 on Ryan Howison's jersey. That number will never be worn again in North Carolina. B.J. Surhoff wore that number when he was the National Player of the Year in 1985, and they were going to go ahead and retire number 9. Howison is a senior. He'll finish out this campaign with it. Throw to first base.
Well, although Mike Roberts is very unpredictable, you can look for him to do something here. They're down 2-1, runner on first base. He's either going to, it's hard to predict, but you would think he's either going to steal the base or hit and run in a situation as soon as he can get the count in his favor.
Fastball at the knees, 0-1.
That may be tough to do with Fletcher spotting that fastball now on the inside part of the plate and throwing that slider that he has great command. 52 pitches, 39 strikes, 13 balls. Most of those balls came in the first inning and a half, and now he's settled down and throwing mainly strikes, which we talked about being his forte and his strength, being able to spot that ball and locate those strikes in and off the plate.
Michael Hoag throwing about 70% strikes today, and Dennis Fletcher about 7 or 8% better than that. Taylor made double play ball. 4-6-3, and the Tar Heels are gone in the fifth inning. Howison hit it hard, but right at Tim Thomas. Rod Stillwell and Jim Calhoun took care of the rest. The Tar Heels in the fifth inning, a hit, nobody left. They trailed 2-1 halfway through the ballgame.
Do you like to draw or paint? Or maybe just sketch or doodle? Well, if you do, chances are you have the interest needed to become a serious art student. And here's how you can find out. By simply calling toll-free, Art Instruction Schools will send you without cost or obligation this enjoyable art test. You take it at home, in your spare time, and when you've finished, you simply mail it in. Your test is then reviewed and graded by experts. So call toll-free today for your art test. And don't let the wonderful world of art pass you by. To get your free art test, call this toll-free number now. Don't delay. Call this number now. Call 1-800-544-1000. That's 1-800-544-1000.
Welcome back to Rosenblatt Stadium, Omaha. Ray night. I'm Bob Carpenter. We've got the best seats in the house for the College World Series, partner.
We certainly do, Bob. I've never viewed very many ball games up like this, and sometimes it's difficult for me to read it, but it is nice to be here and see some exciting baseball.
There's our view down to the diamond. Here's the view from center field on a breaking ball that gets the bottom of the fifth underway. Strike one to Scott Pose. Razorbacks on top of the Tar Heels. 2-1. Pose has singled and popped up. He goes the other way and hits a one-hopper to Ryan Howison.
We got the first one, Mike.
We're seeing a pretty well-pitched ball game here today. These pitchers with good control going right after the hitters. And when the offense knows that, they go up hacking early in the count. Scott Epps, 0 for 2. Breaking ball down and in. Ray Knight and I signed on a couple of days ago talking about how it at least looked like it might be a pitcher's College World Series. All indications were pointing to that, and through the first weekend, it's going that way. Hitters are hitting 230 in the tournament so far, averaging just over 6 runs a game. 6.3. Oh, well hit right to the pitcher. Nicely done by Ho. As recently as 5 years ago, this tournament was averaging 15 runs a game, but not now.
Well, here Hogue throws that sinker away, and he hits the ball right back to him hard. He makes a good plant, just routinely throws him over there once he gets himself gathered and grips that ball with his seams and throws it to first base.
Tough enough to hit these guys, and then they start throwing the gloves at you, too. Bases empty, two outs, and Troy Eklund the hitter. Fastball inside. Eklund singled his last time, caught stealing when he overslid the bag at second. Banned his first time. Down in the dirt with a changeup, ball two.
Getting back to what you said, Bob, that is pretty unbelievable when you look at those stats in 1984 with 15 runs scored and this year 6 runs per inning. So that does live up to the billing you talked about these great pitchers in this series.
6 runs a game for both teams. 6.3 between two teams on the average. Two balls and a strike. 2-1 also the score. Razorbacks with single runs in the second and the fourth. Breaking ball inside. Carolina took the lead with an unearned run in the top of the second inning after Kirk Fisker, the catcher, muffed an easy bunt fly ball. Ron Maurer hit a sack fly. The rest has been Don Thomas of Norm DeBrine's Razorbacks with 2 RBIs on a double and a perfectly executed suicide squeeze.
You see Troy Eklund hit the barrel of his bat right there. Norm DeBrine said that when Troy Eklund is really dangerous, it's when he's ahead in the count 2-1, 3-1, because he looks for that ball in and really tries to get the bat head back. You saw him slap his bat head there because that was a pitch that he felt he could really drive.
Three-two count. Breaking ball outside. Second walk issued by Michael Hoy. Greg D'Alexander, the hitter.
One thing about D'Alexander, he's always ready to hit. He likes the ball in. He loves to hit. He's very aggressive, but he's a dead fastball hitter, which may be tough against Michael Ho because he doesn't throw very many fastballs, and when he does, it has a little bit of movement away, and Alexander likes to pull the ball.
Troy Eklund, 18 of 19 stealing bases this season. Little chopper, third base side. That will not go foul. Ryan Howison didn't think he had a play at first, so he figured he'd better let it roll. It stayed right on the dirt for a base hit. That is an immediate decision the third baseman has to make.
Well, Bob, as close as he plays, see, he's already in there 2 or 3 feet, yards in front of that bag. You've got to come up and make that play. That ball is so far inside, and you take ground balls, and that's what we talk about, knowing the wind, field, ground, and fences. You take ground balls, you get the coaches to roll you ground balls down there, and normally, if it's going to break, it'll break immediately because the team wants the ball to slope foul. So, in my estimation, he should have tried to field that ball and throw him out.
Some of our spotters, some of our crew down on the field telling us that Jesse Levis, the catcher, hollered at Ryan Howison to let it go. And when Jesse says something, they usually believe him. That time it turned out to be the wrong thing to do. Two on, two out. Jim Calhoun is now the big problem for Mike Roberts' Tar Heels.
Well,
not a happy man.
Well, one thing he said, Mike Roberts says, one reason we play the infielders in at the corners is because there's a lot of balls hit in college ball that are short, and we feel that we take that hit away. We may lose a little bit as far as range, but we take that short hit away. That's one of the short hits he's talking about, and that's why he's mad. He knows that that's one thing he sets us up for. That's his game plan, and that ball, he should have made a play on that ball.
Calhoun, 2 for 2 with a single, triple. He's now 3 for 3. A run will score as the ball falls in short right center. Razorbacks at the corners, and the mistake on the infield costing the Tar Heels dearly. He wanted his hitters to be aggressive today. His fielders were not, and Arkansas gets a good run. What a day for Jim Calhoun. Kurt Fisker, the hitter, still two out, two on with a run in.
Well, we talk about aggressive defense, and that's what happens. A couple of plays yesterday in the ball game, they didn't make the plays aggressively, and it led to runs right there. That's why he's mad at Howison, because with two outs, you've got to try to make the play. You're not going to hurt anything, even if you don't make the play.
Fly ball right field. Kieran Villani under it. He grabs it, and the Razorbacks' inning is over. But in the fifth, they get a big run on a walk, a couple of two-out singles, one that didn't make the infield, one that barely did. After 5, Arkansas 3, North Carolina 1.
Get ready. Look up. It's coming your way. The all-time smash hit, show-stopping video, the NFL's greatest hits. And it's free with your paid subscription to Sports Illustrated, the magazine that's a sure hit every week. Call this number now and get all the best action, greatest stars, and biggest plays from the files of NFL films. And it's all rolled up into 45 minutes and will knock you over again and again. But you'll keep getting up for more and more and more. And you can get your hands on it all free. Plus, you won't miss out on the 25th anniversary edition of the famous swimsuit issue. It's an entire issue devoted to 25 years of the best in swimwear. And you'll save over 47% off the cover price. 25 issues payable in 3 monthly installments of only $9.89 each. And you can charge it. Get your free video, the swimsuit issue, and save on SI by calling now. 1-800-777-2100.
It's a red hot June on ESPN. You'll see sizzling shot-making in the early rounds of the U.S. Open and dazzling playmaking in the pressure-packed NCAA College World Series. There's full-throttle excitement with live start and finish coverage of the 24 hours of Le Mans and for horsepower of another kind, a Belmont Stakes Special, plus PBA Summer Tour action and more. The heat is on in June on ESPN.
In 1984, Fullerton State Titan fans were expecting a lot from their club in Omaha. John Fischel made sure they weren't disappointed as he batted .520 for the series with 10 RBIs. He hit 2 homers, including this one off favorite Oklahoma State and over its own heavy-hitting outfielder, Pete Incaviglia. Fischel was named most outstanding player for the series, but he had help. Eddie Delzer was king of the hill for the Titans, winning 2 games, including the clincher against defending champ Texas. It was the second national title in 6 years for Coach Augie Garrido, who was happy to oblige the Fullerton fans.
Let's go.
Mike Roberts. Roberts berating his team after five innings for not being aggressive, for being too passive. Trying to go out of here with a thrill. Tom Nevin leads off the sixth inning. Tar Heels down by a couple. He's seen this happen to his team once in the tournament, Ray, and he doesn't want it to happen again.
Well, he said they've been aggressive all year, and that was really great to watch that right there. I haven't been chewed out too many times by my coach or the team in a meeting like that in the dugout, but I really like that. He's intense. He wants his team to get that intensity. They talked about it. They shuffled the batting order. But especially with two outs, and just think about it, especially with two outs, how can you make a mistake by trying to field the ball? You're playing defensive when you let that ball roll and hope that it goes foul. You field it, and that cost a run, and that's a big, big run.
Then a called third strike, which is the last thing Mike Roberts wanted to see, to his leadoff man. Tom Nevin has been up three times without making contact.
And he's still cooking down there. You see him. And sometimes what happens when you start getting caught up in a situation like this, you go away from doing what's natural. You start swinging at bad pitches, but Mike has the right idea. These kids, they may be a little caught up in this thing now. They're down 3-1. They've heard so much about not being able to score runs that they may get out of their element a little bit right here. And even if they do become aggressive, they may start swinging at bad pitches. But you got to realize one thing, too, that Dennis Fletcher's making a lot of good pitches.
Todd Nichols, 1-for-2. He's hit the ball hard twice, lined to short, single to center. Took a little bit off and missed outside, 2-0. Our flashback a few moments ago, speaking of Augie Garrido, who's now at Illinois. His ball club was in that Northeast Regional at Waterbury, Connecticut, with these Razorbacks. Arkansas winning the number one seed. But the big story was those guys from Lemoyne College in Syracuse. They beat Arkansas in the first round, and the Razorbacks had to edge them 6-5 in the final to get through. And there's a four-pitch walk, putting Nichols aboard, and the Tar Heels now have the tying run at the plate with Brad Woodall. Mike Oquist, a junior right-hander, throwing for the Razorbacks. That was the first walk issued by Dennis Fletcher, who has given four hits, fanning five. Woodall doubled off the right field wall his first time, grounded to shortstop in the third inning. Hacking at a breaking ball and fouling it off his foot.
One thing that Norm DeBrien said that may be of interest to people is the fact that when they make a move here, if they were to bring in Oquist, they'll immediately bring in Tony Gilmore, their number one catcher, because they feel that he's better at stopping the other team's offense.
Mike Roberts was trying to get done over there. He wanted to give these guys a kick in the rear while his team was very much in the ballgame. He doesn't want to have to holler at them after it's 5-1 or 6-1 because his ball club just doesn't come from behind.
Well, Woodall's been aggressive. He swung at the first pitch five of his last seven at-bats in the College World Series, so he's one of the guys, and he's also been an offensive threat on this ball club, so he's one of the guys that he hasn't had to tell to be aggressive.
Well hit, base hit, right field. Runner Nichols had to hold up to avoid being hit by the batted ball. He stops at second base, and the Tar Heels with something going, two on, one out.
Bob, it goes back, and not to hammer, but it goes back to anything you do, whether you're a boxer, you play golf, you play tennis, you win aggressively. Chris Everett was a great baseline player and wore people out with her patience, but she was one in a million. In college baseball and professional baseball, you must be aggressive and attack, attack, attack. Pitchers have to be aggressive, throw strikes, and get ahead of hitters. Hitters have to be aggressive. If the ball's around the plate, you're hacking at it. You cannot hit 0-2 or 1-2. And one thing he also said over there is you watch his team fight the ball off. That's what he's talking about when Jim Calhoun throws those two balls off the right field. They never get in, and you can only win and be successful if you're aggressive.
Pitching coach John Littke to the mound. Two on, one out. Jesse Levis, the hitter. Levis has hit the ball hard twice. Calhoun robbed him on a first base grounder his first time. That would have been a two-out hit to drive in a run. This one is hit long down the right field line, curving foul. About 20 or 25 feet short of the 343 mark, right in the corner.
As we could tell from up here, that ball hooked about 30 feet. Once it got up in that wind, not only did it knock it down, but it pushed it toward that line. So in order to hit a ball out of here, you may have to take it down that right field line, but you're going to have to start it over there about 40 yards at that first light standard, Bob, to hit it out of here. And I still don't think anybody can hit it out that way.
Breaking ball in there, 0-2.
Dennis Fletcher really right now, even though he's given up hits, he's just really making those pitches when he has to.
Tar Heel rally caps on the first base side. Breaking ball to third, it gets back to the screen. That'll move the runners up 90 feet each. It snuck through Kirk Fisker's pads. And a big play for the Tar Heels. Nichols to third, Woodall to second.
Here you see it, Fisker does not get down all the way. He tries to glove this ball, and he doesn't drop down on both knees and square up, and that's when the ball gets fined.
Interesting thing, you can see on that replay, the breaking ball with reverse spin went back the other way, and that fooled him. He actually went too far to get the ball, and the breaking pitch spin took it back on him. There's another one down low, ball two. They'll call it a wild pitch. A base hit. They're getting Carolina back even in this one. They're down 3-1 in the top of the sixth. But Jesse Levis strikes out. Strikeout number six for Dennis Fletcher.
Dennis Fletcher has not thrown very many changeups. Here he comes with a changeup. He's throwing a fastball slider. Look at this changeup fade away. We talked about the fadeaway change. There he is. He gets a 2-2 after throwing sliders and fastballs. Shows him a pitch that he hasn't seen and gets him out.
Dave Arendis, a single, a run scored in two trips. Breaking ball low and away. Fletcher in his sixth inning of work. Only one walk. He's fanned six. And he's never given up more than one hit in any inning. 2-0. Todd Nichols at third. He walked with one out. Brad Woodall followed with a single.